Gerard Rennick there, he's one of the coalition senators threatening to withhold their votes, and he joins us now. Gerard, are you really committed to hijacking the government's agenda between now and the election?
Kerry, I'm committed to making sure people who've suffered adverse events from the vaccines get the proper compensation that they need. And I'm also committed to make sure that those people who can't take the vaccine for valid medical reasons shouldn't be forced to take the vaccine. And once they're given an exemption, they shouldn't be excluded from society.
So do you believe by hijacking the agenda, you will get those things done that you want to get done?
Only time will tell, Kerry. I can't answer that question.
It's a big gamble, isn't it? You're threatening to blow up your own government for the sake of a bill that probably won't pass, aren't you?
Well, I think there's a reasonable chance it will pass if the government decides to put a bill forward that removes discrimination based on vaccination status. I mean, I think we'd get One Nation to support it, and then we'd only need one of the other three crossbenchers to support the bill.
Really, the only vaccine mandates, if you want to call them that, that exist come from state legislation. This is in the federal parliament, this bill that you would be proposing. So you're kind of trying to override state legislation. Do you have legal advice that that's constitutional?
No, I think it's actually federal legislation, section 5123A of the Constitution, which is an amendment to the Constitution, I should add, gave the federal government the powers to legislate on medical services, and that included vaccinations. We also have a Race Discrimination Act, an Age Discrimination Act, an Age Discrimination Act, a Disability Discrimination Act. So I think that the federal government does have the power to override the state mandates on vaccinations.
Right, but you're talking here about discrimination law. How does it offend discrimination law?
Well, why should someone who's got a valid reason not to have a vaccination be discriminated against or not allowed to have a particular job?
Okay, so you're asking... that's a different point. The why should they is a different thing. I'm just asking you, how does it actually offend the law?
It doesn't, and that's my point. Vaccination right. should be included on that, because in the immunisation handbook, the federal government says that you cannot coerce people into taking a vaccine.
But you're not actually forcing them. Like, I get we call them mandates. That's pretty loose, really. It's really a condition. So it's a condition on employment. If you don't want to take the vaccine, you can't be forced to take it. You are free to seek out other employment, for example, or do something like that. So even the idea of banning the government from forcing people to take vaccines is misconceived, isn't it?
Well, no, because if it's not in the employment contract, if you signed a contract and when you signed that contract, it said the conditions of employment, and one of those conditions of employment didn't have anything to do with vaccines, the employer can't change the rules halfway through and go, we're now going to sack you because you haven't got a vaccine.
But a government can, for example. So if a government passes laws under public health orders because there's a pandemic, they're entitled to do that. They're not forcing people to take vaccines. It's a very different thing. If they were forcing people to take vaccines, you would have 100% vaccination or a lot of people in prison.
Well, I would disagree with that. I think taking away someone's job, or in the case of children that can't attend formals because their parents decided that they didn't want them vaccinated, is effectively discriminating against people. It's effectively holding a gun at their head, if you ask me.
But aren't you a member of a government, Senator, that has already passed laws that say you can't send your child to childcare if you're not vaccinated?
That's true.
Why didn't you complain about that when that happened?
Because those vaccines have been around for, you know, decades. Their safety has been well established. The current vaccine is still undergoing longitudinal testing.
So hang on, that's a totally different argument, isn't it, Gerard? Aren't you now saying it's OK for the government to force people to have vaccines, just not these ones?
Well, I mean, I still think it should be the role of the parent to decide whether or not the child gets the vaccine, but not allowing someone to have social benefits in regards to childcare is a completely different thing to threatening someone losing their job when the employment contract didn't necessarily specify vaccination status as one of the terms of condition. Now, I'll make an exception for aged care and hospitals there,
okay.
But in general... you know, day-to-day jobs, for example. I know, for example, fruit pickers are expected to be vaccinated even though they're working outside in the field. I don't necessarily see why that has to be a qualification if you're working outside in a field.
Is it only for people that have medical exemptions that you believe it's not fair for?
Well, I mean, the exit plan was effectively 80%. So we're at 85% double jab now. I would question whether or not we need to exit. You know, we're now past that exit target, certainly for ACT, Victoria and New South Wales. I don't know why we open up. So that's another argument. That's not legislated. That was an agreement with the National Cabinet between the Premiers and the Prime Minister. But I would think that it's up to the Premiers to honour their word and where they said they were going to open up.
All right, Gerard. Well, interesting few weeks and months ahead. Thanks so much for your time.
Sure. Thank you, guys.